Hey, what's up, everybody? You are back here at Channel None and All Now on YouTube, and I am your host, he who will not be named. I wanted to talk real quick about the format for the videos. Obviously, I've scrapped the 6-minute sermons, and the new format that I'm going into is the King's Academy. And it's free advertising for the Khan Academy, which I'm sure most of you are now aware of. There's a guy in Northern California who's using his own webcams and YouTube to give online for free the best math and science teachings available, and he makes them simple and easy to use, and it's really a good resource. It's where the world is going. But there's one set of subjects, that he is not probably going to broach at Khan Academy, and that's why I created the King's Academy here at None and All Now, because there are subjects, like the one we're going to tackle today, that I don't believe he will put a stick to. He's not going to touch it. And today, we're not just going to touch it. We're going to get all up inside it and find the G-spot, baby. Like my name was Barry White and I was singing, whatever, whatever. But the subject for today was inspired by my brother's thread post. My brother from the same mother. I have lots of brothers from other mothers, but I only have one brother from the same mother. And that brother had a post on his Facebook profile that had something to do with kids and dinner tables, and it was really eloquent and really deep and really long, really involved. A lot of people putting some just amazing thoughts and words into action on Facebook there. that really just inspired where I went today, because although it did not start there, it tailed off into its own little rabbit hole. And when it got down to the point where it was basically just a circular argument going around itself, it inspired a question. Is there proof for the concept or the word or the whatever it is that we are saying is God? Let's explore that subject, shall we? So today is our second installment of God. We had God 101, which is a video that we posted a long time ago, and I don't recommend any of you go back and watch it, but you can. It's in our upload history. And today's God 2.0, or God 200 level course, where we're really going to take an advanced look at the concept of God. Okay, and I don't want to say that this look is informed by science, because I feel that that would be offensive to, at the very least, my scientismist friends who don't like the idea that science should be used to examine an idea like God, which, as atheists, they don't even begin with in the first place. So it's right that they should not even be examining that subject. I am not an atheist, and I am not coming from an atheistic or a scientific point of view. However, I am using rational and logos. I am going to be using a structure, and I am going to be very rigorous and thorough in my analyzation. And you can critical think for yourself what determinations you want to make after this. However, I am going to be arguing in the affirmative that God does indeed exist, and I'm going to use a comprehensive, holistic, anthropological set of chronological data or information. Understandings we have about humans and their experience going forward in the annals of what you call time, and how it came to be where it is today, and what the concept of God has to do with all of that. And we're going to be very, very, like I said, we're going to be holistic, comprehensive, and anthropological in this examination. So come with me, please. It's going to be fascinating. Now, in the very, very, very beginning of human history, human beings, and I'm talking about before humans developed the hyoid, which is a vocal apparatus, so before they could communicate through what I'm doing right now, which is talking in a language. So before we had anything close to the English language and the resulting G-O-D thing that happens, you know, that's the three letters that spell the word God in the English language. That word was created or invented or adopted about 1,000 years ago. And it is wholly insufficient starting place for this discussion. So I'm going to move back to before humans even had language, just no vocal apparatus, anything close to what we have today. And this is about 1 million years ago minus. It's within the 100,000 to the million range, let's put it that way. It could be greater than the million range, but I'm going to leave that to the people who do the KAR testing. I'm potassium, argon, all this crazy, you know, soil, you know, stratigraphy and things. It's beyond me to want to go out and rigorously link up a bunch of estimates of time and try to get a good approximation out of those. So that's not what I'm interested in, and other people are, and they can do that. I'm not going to be take those time frames for what they're worth, basically, is caveat emptor. Those are general and they're mine. But I'm saying about 1 million years ago, let's say that. Okay. 1 million years ago, humans don't yet have, or 1.5 million years ago, humans aren't quite with the vocal apparatus yet, right? At this point in time, there is, as far as we understand it, especially anthropologically, there is only one true concern for the human psyche, for the human psychology. On a day-to-day basis, you have one thing and one thing only that you need to worry about most. It's the only thing that's important to you, and it's how do you interface with your environment in more sophisticated nomenclature. It's to you would almost say, how do you manage your ecological relationship with your habitat? And so humans at that point are still very much part of the habitat, just as they are today, and they are completely infused in a relationship with it, and they live in it every day, and they understand it in a way that's very complete for them. But how do they communicate with it? How do they extract information from it, and how do they use the information they extract from it to inform their decisions about where they should migrate next, what foods they should try to eat, what foods they shouldn't try to eat, what things are used for medicines, where they can find water, what fire is, what can it be used for, how to make better stone tools, or whatever it is you're talking about here, right? How to, interact with animals, especially dangerous ones, all different kinds of things that humans have to worry about and have to take very seriously. So what they employed, as far as we understand it, is a method called animism. And that is that the human beings recognize within themselves, and they're not human beings maybe yet, I call them that still, but let's call them hominids for the people who get their, you know, undies in a wad over nomenclature, which I do sometimes. And so should you, not always that much, because too much of that is really bad for everything. But anyways, for those of you who are still with me, hominids at this time are really, really, really invested in the environment, really invested in communicating with it, really invested in understanding it, and really invested in interacting with it, interfacing with the environment in a way that's effective, and hopefully, you know, sustainable. Key word that we're throwing around right now in the year 2012, fashion is in. Anyways, so they're doing this, and the way that they're doing this is that they are taking an awareness that they have extracted from their own relationships, which is a psycho-spiritual linkage that humans have today, and that those hominids have then, and that we view the animal kingdom as being fairly well adapted to, but we view ourselves as being quite separate from. It's basically an organic Wi-Fi system. You are all transmitters and receivers of electromagnetic impulses that are produced from the energy that's being pumped through your heart and your nervous system and your blood and your skin and your bones and your muscles and your thoughts and your actions and everything you're doing. You're putting energy out all around you constantly in this link with the outside world, right? So the ancient hominids a million years ago, they noticed that. They could tell that that was going on, and they were very, you know, ready to then take that information and that knowledge and transplant it to the world around them. Hence, you have animism. So, animism is the system of saying, you know, if I want to know, you know, where are the deer in the forest, what I need to do is I need to go into the forest and I need to make some kind of spiritual, psycho-semantic linkage connection. I need to tap into the forest's organic Wi-Fi. And as this becomes more gross and mechanistic, it becomes like the tracking abilities of like rangers and, you know, Indian men and guys who hunt animals. You notice everything, you hear everything, you smell everything, you just feel your instincts, and you just really, like, you have to really immerse yourself in this dream world that's really well studied and known by anthropologists. I mean, the Aboriginal people in Australia are, you know, obviously famous for theirs, but there are all kinds of other people all over the world who were studied by anthropologists who had this animistic relationship with the universe, where they could really, really, really lose themselves in an imaginative trance state that would bring them into a sensational awareness with the universe around them that was different than what we produce with our stupid ass Western positivist materialist mentality that we have going on. At least some of you have going on. I'm trying to rid myself of it because it sucks. But anyways, so those guys, they're doing that. They're interfacing with their environment, and they're recognizing and realizing that there's spirits in these plants, that there's spirits in these animals, that there's spirits in the water and the rocks and the trees and in the sky and in the mountains and in everything. And that all of it communicates to you and makes noise and waves and breezes and things. And so, like, when the wind blows over here and you say, oh, okay, that's the way to go. Or you smell this and you know that that smell is not associated with that thing because your spirit told you so. Your interface with the spiritual nature of the world told you so. A lot of people, shit-eating, grin, fucking Barrett motherfuckers, who think all this wonderful science is so great, it's taught us all this great shit, don't know anything about ethnobotany and where your current pharmaceutical discourse even comes from. You could take all the chemistry courses in the world, it still wouldn't help you read what's on the back of your toothpaste and understand where those ingredients have been extracted from. And in most cases, well, it's shamans in South America who have used their animistic trance-like states to know what is good for what and what works that are giving you your modern cures for cancer. So y'all can shut the fuck up now. Anyways, uninformed scientists are even worse than uninformed religious people, in my opinion, because they claim to be more informed, yet they are not. But, shelving that debate, moving on. We're going to keep exploring. So, animism becomes what is known as polytheism. As animism becomes more formalized and more positivist materialist, it becomes set into all these different local, regional disciplines and flares. And those things are limited in historicity and in space and time. And they're limited by what eventually would become linguistic components that would be added to them. And they're limited by all of these different aspects of human culture. And so polytheism eventually gives way to something called monotheism, which in a certain culture, they redirected the entire debate of the spirits of the world, right? All of the spirits of the world. First of all, the theism that these spirits are very, like, divine, that they need to be revered, that they need to be worshipped, that to approach them and access their information and their knowledge and make any use of them, you need to treat them with a certain amount of respect and display the proper energy in front of them, which sometimes means making ritual obeisances and things like that. And so by doing these divinatory techniques, you should be able to extract the information that you need to figure out what piece you're missing or what next thing needs to be added, or, you know. And it's Albert Einstein who has argued that we reinfuse science with this because it's already how science informs its discourse. He, in his book Cosmic Religion and in a lot of his other work, he talks about reinfusing science with the religious feeling, which means reinfusing it with imagination, reinfusing it with a willingness to go on a hunch, a whim, a faith. Anyways, so that was to all the atheists who are anti-faith, just so you know, it's not directed towards anyone specifically, my homies specifically who argue this shit with me. So, the human beings, these people have broke their animism, their interactive spiritual relationship with the universe, down into set forms that then we call polytheisms, and then those give way to an even more unified form we call monotheism, which is that at the beginning, all of these different divine entities that rule the sun or the moon or the whatever you want, the ocean, the earth itself, the rocks, the clouds, that tribe of people, whatever it is, that those gods all emanated from the same supernatural source, you know what I'm saying, from the same collective intelligence, that same collective consciousness, the same sense of I am, the same self-awareness, that those things have that self-awareness just as you have that self-awareness. And so then we arrive at the monotheistic and the monadic explorations of universal reality, that there is a universal reality. It's consciousness, right? It's I am, it's I exist. And uncritical and misinformed people will say, oh, well, if you don't have a brain, that doesn't exist. Like, only humans have that. Peace. Like, I don't even need to, like, try to debate that or even go there. I'm not even going to take that seriously. Like Christopher Hitchens says, that which can be asserted without evidence can be dismissed without evidence. I always like to say, the absence of evidence is not the evidence of absence. And it's important for those of you who are stuck on subjective-objective relationships, subjective statements evaluate objective observations. That's what you do in science. You make objective observations, then you analyze them, and you make statements about those analyzations. Subjective-objective, everything's settled. Don't worry about it. Stay with me here, folks. God exists, right? Because people have determined that the universe is conscious, that the universe around us is conscious, and so that the supreme consciousness of the entire freaking universe all at once, that's Allah, that's Brahma, right? But if you are doing what you're supposed to as a good Christian, and if you knew this, you know, if you had studied, you'd understand Christianity is just Hinduism. And so you should be trying to access your own supreme id I am. But then, on top of that, in order to keep everything, you know, nice and, like, clean, we all need to practice non-ego. So it's being without being, or active non-being, as I like to call it. But, hey, those are all discussions for another time. Anyways, ergo, bottom line, the universe is conscious. The universe around you is conscious. Everything in the universe around you is conscious. And people noticed that when they were living in the natural world. Now that you guys have made everything around you and you think everything around you is man-made, you have subtracted the consciousness of the stuff, and you don't think that the universe is still imbued and infused with all this magical, mystical, dripping, honey, juicy nature and energy. And it is! And if you have enough faith and you know how to practice, you can access it, and it is fucking sexy, and you all should learn. But that's another lesson for another day, so maybe you want to come back and get some another time. Goodbye.